So we'll be talking about what's new in Drupal 8 Multilingual and why it's so awesome. Myself, I'm Chakrapani. I work with a company called Azure Solutions. And I've been working with Drupal since 2009. And I'm the lead organizer of Drupal Bangalore community. And I've been speaking at various camps. I was a speaker at DrupalCamp, DC. I spoke at NYC Camp, New York. So this was the same session which I spoke at DrupalCamp. A little bit of overview about what we'll be talking. So the language first installer. If you have any questions, you can stop right there. No need to wait until the end of the session. And we'll talk about four multilingual modules. And optional and translatable English. Language detection options in Drupal 8. Language visibility and filtering. Transliteration. And improved translation UI. And finally, content and configuration translations. So what is language first installer? So in Drupal 8, the moment you start installing Drupal, so you'll get a screen which will ask you to choose your language. And it's an advanced installer where it will pick the language from your browser. So if your browser have a language setup, so Drupal will pick the browser's language and make it as a default. And if you want the same language for your Drupal site, you can just click next and continue. Otherwise, it's English. And automated translation downloader. So in the first step, you will be choosing language. So what happens if you choose something other than English? Drupal will automatically download all the translations for that particular language and remove English completely. Yeah, so if the chosen language is other than English, English is removed and all the translations will be downloaded for the language which you choose. And complete RTL support from the first step. So if your language is something like Arabic or any other language which is right to left, Drupal will support right to left from the beginning. So the moment you choose Arabic, the next screen you will see from right to left. So this is the installer first step. So if you choose English, so if you choose Spanish, it will tell you translations will be downloaded from Drupal translation website. Yeah. So if you choose Arabic, the next screen will be like this. So we'll have all the styles required, all the support for the RTL from the next step itself. So more core modules. So generally we say that if you have more modules, it's bad. But then why am I talking about more core modules is good? It's because it's four core modules which will replace 20 plus contributed modules. So if you need a full-fledged multilingual site in Drupal 7, you need to install like 24 to 25 modules to get this. In Drupal 8, you will get that with just 4 modules. So these are the 4 modules. Configuration translation, or content translation, interface translation, and language. So language module is the base module which does the heavy lifting and provides all the multilingual support. All the 3 other modules are supporting modules. So the base language services is provided by the language module, which actually provides all the support. So the interface translation will provide you the UI for translations, and content translation will provide you UI support for the content translation, wherein the actual heavy lifting is done by a language module again. The same is the case with configuration translation. The configuration translation is actually supported by the language module, but the configuration translation module gives you UI to use it. Simple language setup and optional English. So the language overview screen is very simple. You can see a screenshot. And you can add and remove languages easily, and including English. You could remove English as well. So no more disabled languages. In Drupal 7, you could disable a language. So consider if you have a content and you disable that language for some time, you will have a lot of content which is obsolete, which if the language is actually disabled, but that is stored in the DB and all. It's a lot of confusion. In Drupal 8, you could either have a language or you don't. So there is no disabled languages. So this is the language overview screen. If you see here, Hindi is the one which is my default language. So you'll see only edit option over here. For English, which is my secondary language, you'll see edit and delete, which means you can actually delete English. So if you need a site in Japanese or Spanish, you could just install it in that language. You don't need to have English as a base language.
Yes. Sir, if you delete some language, then the content will be there or it will be removed?
It will be deleted. So when you delete a language, it means that you don't need a language. And you will not have those confusion like where content will sit in the back end thinking which language it will be.
Yeah. In instance, I have languages.
So the multilingual system, if you, let's say you start with Japanese, the basic installation. So the site will be installed in Japanese. So you'll have only one language. Even you won't see the English, you can actually start with Japanese. So in this screen, you add a language. So your site will be supported in so many number of languages that you add from here. Which means you need to add those languages. So if you add Hindi over here, it will download the translations for Hindi. Then you will be able to see your site in Hindi. Yes. Yes. So the user added content is not translated automatically, but all the user interface and everything else is translated. And that's downloaded from Drupal.com.
Drupal 7 is, though they say that it's translated. So Drupal 7, though they say that it is translated, the translatable modules are available, it is not fully translated. If you look at the admin panel, a lot of terms are still are in English.
Yes, exactly. See, the translations are not a big problem. Translations is something which a community provides or Drupal.org has. Even now, there might be few words or text or sentences which doesn't have a translation. So that's not a problem because you could translate them. The problem is, even though you can get translation, there are a lot of elements in the site which if you need to translate, you don't know how to do them. And Drupal 7 doesn't support all of them. And even though if you need the support, you need to go for a lot of contributed modules which implement their own logic. It doesn't have to follow any rule that you know. This is how code is, I need to follow that. You need a problem, a contributed module can fix it anyway. Because Drupal 7 doesn't support multilingual for everything. So when you are providing a solution, they can provide it any which way. And you have four different modules which provide your solution in four different ways. It's not good for your site.
I have a question. See, it said the previous screen, once I choose the language, automatically the admin interface also changes to that language.
Yes.
Can I have the site in different languages?
Yes, yes, you can. I'll get to that. I have a screen. So you can have a site in one language where users will see admin interface in another language. You can do that. Yes. Okay. So this is the language did screen. It's very simple again. All you have to do is use the code for the language and then the title of the language. And most important, you need to choose whether the language is right to left or left to right. So based on that, your styles will be updated. If you choose it right to left, all your styles will be right to left. Yeah, so here is the answer. So for the interface language detection, so these are the rules you need to configure. So based on these rules, your site will decide the language, which language it should display. So it could be URL, session parameter, or user preference or browser language. So you need to give the preference. Whichever is on the top, that you get the preference. So for example, in your case, if admin has to have a different language, you can move the account administration pages setting to the top and configure it. So that way, when somebody logs in, it will check if he is an admin. If he is an admin, it will pick the language for the admin. And if he is not the admin, it will fall back to the second rule, that could be URL or session or whatever. So this is for the interface of language detection.
Is it really sequential?
Sorry?
Is it really sequential?
I mean,
if I select
Yes.
What if I do URL and source?
See, if you if this is how it was set up, and if you have URL slash en, click en. So when you don't have URL and you have set it in the session, I mean like you need to enable it as well.
Right.
So if you have all of them enabled and the system don't find anything in the URL, then it fall back to the second rule which you have set up. And if your session has a variable saying that damage code is equal to something, you go to that.
See, yes. If I have installed high languages, I can get I content type that means in one active and using one.
Yes. Content translation is supported, we'll get to that. I'll have a yes. 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 So it's the same screen for again content language detection. So there is interface where somebody needs to see the admin interface, and there is also content. So you could have different rules for content and different rules for interface. So when you are in the Node app page, how you see the title on those text, that will be the interface. And the actual content which is added by the user. So you might need to have different rules. Like when my user comes, I need to have different rule set. But if I need somebody like admin or editor, you might need to have different rules. So it's completely possible in Drupal 8. And you can choose to have same as well. Yeah. So this is the configuration page for each of the settings. So if you need to set up the from the URL, you need to choose what are the codes, like, you know, these are the settings. Similarly for the language detection. So for example, I was talking about Drupal 8 will pick language from the browser. So the browser will by default have some codes for the language. Like we have different browsers. If we have a new language code which need to use up, a modern browser which uses a different code for a particular, you know, language, you could configure that here. You could add that here along with the others. So for the session language negotiation, so I was talking about if you pick the language from the session. So you can set the which variable in the session. So when they say from the session, you need to have a variable from where it has to pick a language. So you could say the language or something else, my variable or something. So if that has a language code, you can pick that particular language. Limitless language assignment and extensible special languages. So generally aside, not everything is translatable. So there will be some things which doesn't need to have a language, or there might be content where you need to add a language later on. I mean like I'm adding a concept right now, but I don't know which language it will be, or something like that. So in Drupal 7 for this we have something called language neutral. But for both the cases where you don't actually need a language or you might actually add a language later on, both of them we need to use language neutral. But in reality for the content which you already know that it will never have a language, which means the language is not applicable, you still need to have this language. This is a special language. So that additional functionality was there for that. So in Drupal 8, we have two special languages, not applicable and not specified. So not specified is something which you can later on change into some other language which you need. And not applicable is something which you will never have to assign a language on that piece of content.
I can always start, right? Currently if I set it as not applicable and eventually if I feel that I have to set it as not specified.
See, you can change it. The point is when you actually assign a language or if you specify that particular content has a language, it will have different configurations and it need to load everything. It need to check for which language it is. If I have a content in that particular language or we have translations. For example, if I have a content in one particular language, it will need to check if it has any translation. All those functionality will be tied to that particular piece of content. When you specifically specify that it's not like not applicable, it doesn't have to do all the language related stuff. Yeah. So you can extend these special languages to Drupal 8 with a contributor module. If you need something else, you know, which is a special case language, you could do that. So now you can create views in any language. So earlier you need to create views in English and then, you know, translate into Spanish. Even though if you are using a particular view only in Spanish, you still need to create a view in English. So that's true. You no longer need to do that. You can whichever language you want. And content entities with bundles are more flexible. So in Drupal 7, all the content types, adding multilingual support for that is a really big pain, especially with all the fields and all. We'll see how this is easier. Yeah, so this Drupal 8 expands it to all entity types and bundles, and which include comments, users, taxonomy terms, nodes, menus, and custom blocks. Basically everything. So all these are entities in Drupal 8, and multilingual is supported for all these entities. Yeah. And this is the best part. So for all these entities, you have one centralized screen where you can configure whether you need multilingual support for these or not. For taxonomy, for users, for comments, for nodes, menus, etc. If it were in Drupal 8, Drupal 7, for each of the content types, you need to go to the edit page of the content type and enable the multilingual support, and then come back to the fields, and then edit and change. And each and every element you need to configure. You need to go back to the taxonomy pages and then enable the language in another tab, and then come back and then do it. So in Drupal 8, you have one simple screen where you can configure everything. Yes.
So I do what it has been given field or translation region to.
Correct.
So the same thing you are doing, right?
Yeah, it's similar, but in Drupal 7 it's not supported by default, it's not supported by the code. You need to have a lot of modules and the implementation is not very great either. But the support is different here. I'll talk how it is different. If you see the next two speeds will
happen. Between entity translation or core in V8 or
yeah, it's entity translation different. Yes. So if you see this screen, you have language settings, you could choose for which elements or entities you need the multilingual support, comments, content, custom block, etc. And when you choose something, you will immediately get this, whether you need, how you need to configure your language detection or anything to the comments. And if you actually see the content types. So when I choose content translation, it will automatically enable multilingual support for all the content types available. And the moment you enable the multilingual support for one particular content type, you will see list of all the fields which are translatable. So you could choose which fields you need multilingual support for. This one particular thing to configure in Drupal 7 could take 2 to 3 hours. This you could do in 1 minute. So for all the entities, you get settings right there. You could choose how you want to do it. So for example, if you have image field, you don't need it. So you could just uncheck or just
check. Yes, the machine name remains same. So you choose translation for title or a custom field.
Yes,
machine name remains the same.
Yes, it does remain the same, but it depends on which language you are adding. If you have, like, if you have a Spanish site and you don't have English, and you would add something in Spanish, but that's where the transliteration support comes. I know there's a transliteration support. I have a screen for that article. So where naturally convert into the nearest translation. Okay, so easier, write to them style, guys, please, there's no mic, I need to shout. So language settings include RTL or LTL. So as we have seen in the language settings in the edit page, for every language you need to choose whether it is right to left or left to right. Why that is bad and why this is good. So let have slide of CSS which has 500 lines of code, and you need to convert that into OTL. I mean, you need to like put both of them here and then like do this. But in this case, you could just do it right away, because writing it CSS for one particular element, you can do it for both RTL and left right. Yeah, this now already is. Okay, so language visibility and filtering. Block visibility. So we have support for blocks where you could choose in which language a particular block should appear. And extended visibility settings for language. So, for example, someone was asking any different menus. So, if you need different menus for different language size, so let's say you want to create menus using your block, for example. You create a block and choose this particular block should appear in English. So, you will have an option of this block in which language it should appear. So, just choose English. And you could create another block and choose Spanish, where the menus could be completely different. I mean, you could use translation if you need to, where you have all the same menus but translated. Or you could choose different blocks wherein you need different menus put together. Yes, so that once you enable the content translation, you will get an option to translate that particular content.
You can get an article in Hindi also?
Yes, you can. Yes. Correct. So if you have a Hindi language enabled, so if you want to create an article in Hindi, so you can just go to create article page in the language drop down, you'll see Hindi. So just choose Hindi and then create.
And then all the Hindi sites, how will the SEO model be impacted?
So that actually completely depends on search, but search also, Multilingual provides support for search as well. So in the index, there will be a language variant. So you could ask, even in the search page, you could send search only in this particular language. If you have Spanish and English as well, so you could search from a particular language. If the user is coming in, like let's say Spanish site, and he does a search, so there's no point searching in English content. So the system can actually send a variant saying that my language is Spanish, that will only return Spanish. The important thing is having that tracking ability, having that filtering ability. Yeah, as I told, Drupal allows you to configure a separate language negotiation method for content and interface translation. So this is how the block configuration page will look. So you can choose which language your block should appear. And use language. So in views also you can have language filtering. So when you are creating a view and showing the content, you can have a filter where content is from English and Spanish, or content is from only Hindi. Or you could just export this form to the user itself, you know, where the user can actually choose the language. So transliteration in code. So DrupalCamp now comes with a powerful transliteration. And currently it uses for machine name generation. So what should I say? So when you add a content name, for example, in Hindi, like you put your content in Hindi, it will translate it to create a machine name. Have a speech or something. Okay, this is the one. So if you see, this is a Hindi text, it transliterates and actually creates a machine. You can actually extend this transliteration from the code. I mean, the code is used, I mean, right now this is one of the use cases where transliteration is used, but you can extend it and you know, you can have a search box where if your users are in Hindi or Spanish, when they type, it could actually transliterate. Okay, so deployment ready automated download. So I told you that DrupalCamp will actually download the translation. Like, the moment you choose any language, it will download all the translations that are required for that particular language. So how do you maintain them? So if it were in a database, it will be very difficult to manage. So all these downloads, all these translations are deployment friendly. So which means they are stored in a central directory, and you could actually control them via let's say you install your Drupal 8 site today and you have some translations downloaded from the community. But at any point in time, not all the translations are complete. So there is always work going on, there is always updates. So you could configure your site to automatically get the updated translations from Drupal.org itself. So you could set the frequency, check every week, check every month, or don't check. So based on that, you can check if there are any new translations in Drupal.org, download them and update them. So now when I say deployment friendly, let's see how we can actually use this. So let us say in dev environment, I can enable automatic translation. Because if you enable it in production and have automatic download, it could download any translation and show them to your users. But what if they were wrong, or you need to show something which is different? Because in any language, it might be more than one word for a particular situation. For example, even in English, there is signing and login. So some people might prefer login with respect to signing and so on. So what you can actually do is, in your dev environment, you can actually enable the automatic downloads and then disable them in the staging and production. So in your dev once you have automatic downloads, you can actually see the git dev, because all these files are stored in a central file there. You can see the git dev and see what translations are downloaded. If they are okay, you can actually commit them to staging and then test them and push them to production as well. In the production, so if you just push them, it won't work because you need to import the translation. So Drupal not only downloads the translations by default, it actually imports the translations into Drupal. So at the end of the day, in the backend, in the digital. So what you can configure in the production is, you can configure importing from your file system itself, rather than getting from the Drupal.org. So when I say automatic downloads, it could be from Drupal.org, or it could be some public URL where you have better translations than Drupal.org, or it could be from your own file.
Sorry.
Yes. So in there, you have the automatic downloads enabled. So whenever there are new updates, you will get them in your dev. So you test them in your dev or staging. And then if you are okay, then you commit and push them to production.
Will that go automatically on the...
Yes, so in your production, you configure your automatic downloads. You can configure the source where the translations are downloaded. So that source will be your own file and file directory. So where you commit that particular file or directory.
It should be directly.
Yes.
Is it part of the custom translation?
Yes, it is. Yeah, so importing type to be done from a reconfigured directory. So these are the settings. You could choose check for updates, never, weekly or monthly. And here you see translation source, Drupal translation server and local files, and then local files only. So you can actually configure the local file system and then commit those files. And okay, when you also download those translations, you will always have custom translations. Like when you download it initially, there was no translations for particular modes, you translate them manually. So again, when the translation is available for those particular modes later on, then they pump it because you have translated something and there's a new translation for that. So you could configure how those are handled. So do you want to overwrite them by default, or never overwrite them, or overwrite them by, you know, consider them as custom translations and so on. So you have all the flexibility, so you can do however you want. Context-specific translation it is. So you no longer need to use get underscore t and st. In Drupal 7, t can be used only after db was set up. If your db was not set up, for example, in the installation step, you can't use t function. ST should be used during those installation steps and all. And otherwise you need to use get underscore t. So if you don't know where this particular piece of code is used and you need to use the translation, then you need to use get underscore t, which will check if the database is set up or not. If it is set up, it will return t, otherwise it will return ST. In Drupal 8, it is handled within t, so you don't need to think of these things. Because anyways, all you need is Drupal can be smart. You can check if the Drupal 8
DD is set up or not. So within the key function, it will check.
So every human English custom English sentence that we have, we have to add key function.
Yes, if you want it to be translatable. So context in Jupyter, we have a Jupyter format plural. So D sub n, T function and format plural could actually take context. So which helps the translator to translate ambiguous text. So this is now extended to their JS counterpart. So it was only available for T functions. Now it is extended to Jupyter.t as well. So now the T layer is no longer the PHP template, it's a quick. So you no longer can use the T when you are adding the translations in the T layer. So you could just use the T of trans and this. That's how you could use it in Greek syntax. It's equivalent of T. And if you have a singular or a plural context, you could use the block string. All the string assemblations are tracked. As I told earlier, when a translation is downloaded, it is tracked. If you do a manual click, it is tracked. So you choose when you are exporting or importing, you could choose how you want to do it. So let us say now I am exporting it, I could choose include non-customized translations or include customized translations. So this gives us a clear differentiation between what is downloaded from Drupal.org and what is actually manually translated. So if you have a translator who is translating, in your Drupal site, you just go there and download fully customized translations. Or you could download only untranslated text and send it to the translator somebody who will translate. And later when you import, you will have the same options. You could choose how you want those translations to be. If it is imported manually, you could choose them as custom translations. So, okay, English is now translated. So what does that mean? So by default, if you see, for English, interface translation is not applicable. And if you actually go to the edit screen, you can see an option where enabling interface translation to English. So what does this actually mean? So what it means is, English by default will have some text. Let's say, signing in login is the best example. So it comes with sign. You can treat it as another language which is translated. So by default, whatever you see, it reads as translated. So you could choose signing and translate it to login. So that's the best example. So for any earlier you used to use a string overrides, right? So you no longer need to use string overrides. You could just enable English as a translated language and you could just translate.
US English to US English?
Yes, see basically for the system it's a language. So if you so that would be one best example. So Drupal code comes with US English. Let's say you need British English. So just make English as translated. So translate all the text which is in US English to your British English. So basically English is treated as any other language. But except code is in English. Okay, so improved translation. How many of you built multilingual sites in Drupal 7? So how many of you worked with translators and gave them interface, your Drupal 7 interface? Why did all of you give your interface? How easy was it to use? In Drupal 7, if you need to translate any text, first you need to go to the translation settings and then search for the keyword and then you need to go to that particular language, particular keyword actually, and you will see all the languages. So how many translators are experts in translating one particular keyword from one particular language to multiple other languages? Generally it will be like translate from one to another, or most cases 2 or 3 if it is big. So I don't think there's any translator who can translate into 10 languages. So in most of the cases, you'll have a one-to-one translation, English to Hindi or English to Telugu. Those are the experts you see. So there's no point giving them all other options, you know, where they have to, when they have to translate, they need to do 3 to 4 clicks for every word translation. So in Drupal 8, everything is centralized. The moment you choose the language, you see all the list of text here. Search as and your translation, you could just enter it. So for all the list of things, if I need a Hindi translation, I can just keep on adding one screen in something. It doesn't need to go to like multiple screens. So in Drupal 7, if you need to translate, like, let's say 10 words or 10 sentences, you might need to like 40 times at least. So, which also means going to 40 pages. So, how much time and effort it will take? And this is just one screen. It will be like, you know, all you need to do is go to Hindi, fill up all the everything, you will have a page, just fill up everything, whatever is blank, or next. Yeah. So, this is the extension of it. So, there will be page, you could search, and this was the context I was talking about. So we'll see whether it is in plural context, how it has to be translated. Compare and configuration translations. D7 provides translation capabilities for notes, but no other content or configuration. I mean, D7 code doesn't support any other translation other than node. If you need a field error or configuration, you need to use contributed modules which give their own solutions. So if you needed to translate blocks, terms or menus, with Drupal 7 you can't. So you need to go for contributed modules. Yeah. So these are the modules, you know, like IIN menu, IIN block, there are some other performance to look like. There is no rule that, you know, even the module names has to be like this. If the module names are itself different, they are not following any pattern. Like, there are a few ways for us, but definitely they are like different modules which are coming from different people. If the module name itself is not consistent, imagine how the solution would be. So if I am creating a solution for some particular problem, let's say I am creating a solution for translate views, I definitely not take the other way how he is handling it between translations. All I would think about is, okay, how easily I could actually provide a solution to feed that. So when you are using 20 modules like that, just imagine how much effect will be on your market. So Drupal 8 has general based solution in code. As I told, the language module itself provides solution for everything. It supports or content translation, field level, configuration, entities, everything. So generally mostly we work with either configuration or content, which are all entities. So content entities almost all have fields, which users, comments, you could add fields. And as I told, fields come with native support for multilingual stuff. So your contributed module or any module which needs it doesn't need to go create a table for storing the translation whichever way of table. Simply the base module itself provides the support. All you need to do is just enable the UI module so that you can actually use them. Every piece of content is now translated. You no longer need any of those 20 plus modules, they will be obsolete. That was the negative. I never thought of it. So 20 modules, you don't need to upgrade them to Drupal 8. So configuration translations, we have full support for configuration translations. All values stored in configuration may have a language variance. I mean, you might or you might not have, but in general, configurations which are stored in YAML files might have a language variance. Yeah. And when you are actually loading those configurations, Drupal 8 lets you load based on the language as well. So if you need to load a configuration for some particular field or for some particular view, you can also suggest just give me the configuration for this particular language. all these variants overwrites are fully deployment friendly. Because these configuration files, these are files, are not the same files. So they are chartable to where I go. So even default shipped configurations are translatable. You see, when you install Drupal 8, even in English, there are a lot of configurations which are actually shipped with Drupal 8 code as well. Like, for example, site information page, that is a configuration, that is a file. So it has a language variant where you could actually translate. Even use content types fields, you do get few of these when you actually install Drupal 8. So as I told earlier, the config translation module just provides the UI to you. The base for the language module actually does that for you. The language module is which actually defines the schema, which defines how translations are actually handled. So this is the configuration screen for the configuration translations. So you will see all the list of different elements where you know, you could go on translate the configurations itself. Okay. So, how many of you are clear that what are configurations? Clear differentiation between like what actually is configuration? Because I'm talking about interface translation, I'm talking about content translation, I'm talking about configuration translation. So let's say when you are creating a content type, so you define your field name, you define your content type name, and so on. So all those are configurations. For example, in the site information, you have a site name and site slogan and so on. These are the configurations. So basically, whatever the elements or content that is added by the user is content. And you know, when you go to the node app page, whatever you will enter is content. But when you actually configure the content type, whatever you do as a site admin, those are all configurations. Okay, here is a diagram where you could actually differentiate it. So, under content, nodes, users, comments, when I say nodes, it's a node content. And comments, contact, messages, not the form or not the page or anything, but the actual content messages is content. And terms, not the vocabularies. The vocabulary is a configuration which depends where you actually enter the terms of the content where user is putting. And menu items. So configurations are views, vocabularies, which actually define the structure of your site or a page. And contact categories, fields, menus, so you define fields and then user will be able to use those fields. Menus, site info, user names, etc. So, how are these handled? I think Google has already spoke about this. So, basically, this is the YAML file which actually stores the configuration for site info. When you install your Drupal 8 site, this is the file from where the configurations are taken. It's actually similar to your default node settings for PHP. So, what Drupal 8 does when you install your site is it actually copies this particular file and fills those blank elements. So, it fills the UID, fills the name, slogan, page, etc. You leave it blank with that. So, if your language is not English, this is the default configuration file for the site information. If a language is not English, so the copy file will be in Spanish. And then the language variants by which is copied will only have the elements which are changed, which are specific to that particular language. Yes, you will have multiple files. And you will have those additional files only if you have a language variant for this configuration. For example, if I have a site information page where I really don't have any different configurations for different sites, I just have one here. So only it will be copied if I have a different language for those configurations. So for example, if you have a view, which is used on those and which there is no difference. So those configurations are not, files are not. Different teams for different languages. That is why this file is stored in that particular team. No, you don't need this file. You have file for the configurations. You have file languages and you have file and Yaman files depends on what configuration. It's only for configuration. So all your configurations are stored in Yaman files. And if your particular configuration needs an admin query, then only your file will be copied into that
particular language. Is it possible if three different languages are
allocated and do that. Generally, you could have different teams based on context, so your context could be language. This is how it will work. For the site information, these are all the elements which are very important. If I install my site in Spanish, so the configurations are copied and pasted. Only these are the elements which are actually changed. So these are these will be available in the Spanish configuration, right? And which are the elements which are these are already installed in Spanish. So you could find the sites in bb/da-multilingual and a couple of other references as well. You can find all good information from papers now. Please the DrupalCamp multilingual shape. Thank you.